This sermon is from Edgewood Baptist Church. You can find more information about us online at ebc-edmonds.org. Thanks for listening.
We'll be looking at the Gospel of John, the 20th chapter, verses 24 through 31, and we'll be talking about overcoming doubt and disbelief. There are events in life, there are circumstances in life that can catapult us, into a period of doubt and even disbelief. In years of doing ministry, I know that's true. I've talked to folks and they've told me, I used to believe, but I'm struggling to believe, or I don't believe anymore. And when you say, what led to this? What was the precipitating factor? What was it that launched you into this period of doubt and disbelief? And sometimes it can be the fall of another Christian acting in a way that was really hurtful. And say, well, I used to believe, but if those folks who claim to know Jesus live that way, then I don't know if I can believe in Jesus anymore. Which is kind of interesting when you think about it, because Jesus warned that there would be hypocrites, people pretending to be Christians who aren't. He warned that there would be hypocrites who would come, false prophets, and he called them wolves in sheep's clothing. We know that that happens. We also know that we all struggle with some inconsistencies in our lives, don't we? So we shouldn't reject Jesus when we see somebody who claims to follow Jesus living in ways they shouldn't. But if the truth is, sometimes it does raise doubts in our mind, doesn't it? Sometimes it's a circumstance. Sometimes it's an unanswered prayer that gets us doubting. Philip Yancey tells of a young man who was studying in seminary. He devoted his life to Christ and now wanted to live his life sharing Jesus with others. Everything was going well, and then his fiance broke up with him and some other things happened, and he started to question if God was even there. Isn't it interesting how life can be that? Sometimes really hard things happen and they strengthen our faith, and things that aren't quite as hard happen and they cause doubt and disbelief. And he's wondering, why is this happening? Why is my fiance breaking up with me? Why am I having these financial pressures? And so he decides that what he's going to do is he's going to pray and have God reveal himself to him in a supernatural way immediately. And if God does not do that, he's done with God. So he prays for some supernatural sign. No supernatural sign comes. He goes out in his backyard. He's got his big barbecue out there, and his Weber barbecue, and he just throws in all of his seminary books, his Bible, lighter fluid, throws a match in there and just burns it up. Says, I'm done. What would we say to him if we had a chance to speak into his life? But let me say this. Today's sermon isn't only about how we speak to people who have doubt and disbelief. It's about dealing with our own doubt and disbelief. I've written about and shared about the story of when I was away at vacation and a friend of ours was in her 20s, died of a brain aneurysm suddenly, leaving three small children behind. And of driving from the cabin I was at to the hospital to meet the husband. And within that vehicle, as I drove, there just became a darkness and a doubt. Why, God, why is this happening? I've been talking to this couple, look like they're moving forward in their relationship with you, and now this happens. And And what will I say when I get to the hospital room? And the thought crept in my mind, well, what if this is just some kind of fairy tale I'm making up? How do I know that you're real, God? Have you ever had a moment like that? I don't want to leave this story there. I'll tell you what happened on the rest of the trip. But I want to turn to look at the life of Thomas. Sometimes we call him Doubting Thomas in our culture. I don't know if that's exactly fair. The other apostles had and disciples had their doubts too, right? I mean, it may be that Thomas was one of those the glasses half empty kind of guys. I'm not sure. We know this. Then in John 11, the 11th chapter, the 6th verse, which is talking about Jesus at this point has been told of Lazarus, and Lazarus' sickness, and he's been called to go see him. And the disciples are concerned about persecution in that area. And in John 11, 6, Thomas says this, Thomas called the twins, said to his fellow disciples, let us also go that we may die with him. Not a really optimistic message, right? In John 14, Jesus says, if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. You know the way to where I'm going. And it's Thomas who says, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way? To which Jesus responded, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. Aren't you glad Thomas asked the question? But let's pick up today's text. Verse 24, now Thomas, one of the 12. So we know Thomas was one of the 12 disciples. Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So Jesus had come, the risen Christ had come to the disciples, but when he came, Thomas wasn't there. So the other disciples told him, we have seen the Lord. But he said to them, unless I see in his hands the marks of the nails and place my finger in the marks of the nails and place my hand into his side, I will never believe. Sounds more than just doubt, right? Unless I can have this happen, I'll never believe. Verse 26. 8 days later. Did you catch that? 8 days later. What was it like in that period of time for Thomas? In that period of disbelief? You see, that day that I was driving to the hospital and I prayed out to God, I believe, help my unbelief. God spoke to me in a powerful way with his presence. And by the time I arrived at the hospital room, I felt ready by the grace of God to speak into the situation and knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that Jesus was real. Amen? And it was on the road just knowing that my faith wasn't in my faith. My faith was in my God. Jesus truly is the author and perfecter of our faith. Do you get the difference? There's a lot of people out there that think it's all about my faith. I don't trust my own faith. I trust my God. And sometimes I cry out, Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. Do we know that prayer? But can I say to you that it doesn't always just go away, these periods of doubt and disbelief, in an hour. We live in the sitcom drama era. People are laughing at the phone ringing. If it's a direct call from God, that'd be something, right? I don't think it is. But we live in this area of sitcoms and dramas, and maybe in 30 minutes or 50 minutes or 45 minutes if there's a lot of commercials in it anyway. In the time of the drama, the problem solved, right? But Thomas, 8 days later. And I just want to say, when we're dealing with doubt and disbelief, and when we're helping other people deal with doubt and disbelief, let's make sure we don't think like one Sunday school ought to settle it. One Sunday school class ought to get that done. You have a little question about that? Boom, I got a class, you're done. Because, you know, sometimes Christians come across that way, don't they? We'll help you with your doubt long as it doesn't take too long. I got you half an hour. What's your problem? Okay, fine. Eight days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Thomas was where? With them. Did you get that? They didn't break fellowship. Oh, you don't believe, you're out of here. I understand we need to guard doctrine. I understand there's things for membership, but I also understand we need to show love to people who are having doubts and disbeliefs. True? And when we're in doubt and disbelief, let's make sure we don't just disassociate ourselves from the Christian community. So he was with them. Eight days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Praise the Lord. Peace be with you. Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here, see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." You see what happened? The road through disbelief led to even greater faith for Thomas. My Lord and my God. Doesn't say he actually put his fingers in those wounds. He saw the presence of Jesus. Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in His name. So Jesus says to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." I think the point is, people who won't physically see Jesus in his resurrected body that will believe, and blessed are they. Amen? There's this experience I had sitting at a church service. And I was sitting in the bleachers. It was a high school gym turned into sanctuary for this occasion, okay? There were lots and lots of people there, and I was sitting in the bleachers, and I could look down, and on the ground below, there was a pin. Okay? You got it? And I'd been struggling with some doubts. I was in seminary. And I said to God, "If you're really there, just move that. Just a little bit one way or the other, that would be fine. I mean, I'm dedicating my life to you. I'm in seminary. Just move it a little bit." I mean, kind of a weird story, right? But it didn't move. But I felt the presence of the Holy Spirit. And I felt the words placed on my heart from Scripture. A wicked and adulterous generation looks for a sign, but no sign will be given to you. You remember that? He goes on to talk about the resurrection of Christ as evidence. Now, you may say that's weird, but for me, it was a confirming thing that there's enough evidence of Christ's resurrection. I don't need him to move that thing. Right? He's changed my life. He's made a difference. His resurrection is true. All time is counted according to the coming of Christ. He's changed my life. He's changed so many lives. I've seen so many things he's done. Praise the Lord. So blessed are we when we believe. He's not saying that you can't investigate the evidence. We should. He's just saying don't call out for some supernatural thing all the time. There's plenty of evidence of God on the works of Christ all around us. John ends this section by telling us that these things have been written so that we might believe in Christ. There's many things that John could have said. There's stories he doesn't tell when he was one of the three in a very elite little circle. He doesn't tell that story, although the other Gospels do, because he's not about making much of himself. He wants to point you to Christ. And that's very important when we're dealing with people who are dealing with doubt and disbelief. That as we speak into their lives, that we understand that we are helping them so that they'll make much of Christ, not so that they'll think great thoughts about us. Well, here's the points of the outline I want to walk us through. Narrative's not imperative. So when we hear the story of Thomas, we can't say, this is a command what you should do. But I do think there's some lessons we can learn from what we've just seen. Amen? And apply them to our life. First point is declare your doubt and disbelief. Thomas tells him, I'm not going to believe unless this happens. Here's the thing. There are many people who attend church. They have these doubts, they have these disbeliefs, and they pretend they don't. So when the question comes in Sunday school or church, they give the biblical answer, but they have doubts about it. And when our doubts and disbeliefs aren't dealt with, they grow worse. Who do you declare them to? People that love you, people who know you, people who know Jesus. One of the things that I like to emphasize as often as I can is that if you come upon something that causes you to doubt, and there's many things that can cause doubts, right? Right? I could be reading the Bible and say, I don't understand this. Paul seems a little arrogant here, or chauvinistic in his writing here, or this verse doesn't really make sense to me, or I'm not sure why God ordered that, and you start to doubt some things. What should you do with those doubts? Or you're in a college class and some questions are raised and you don't have an answer for them. What should you do? What a lot of people have done is they've just tried to suppress that doubt and not deal with it. But what I think we should do is declare it, get it out in the open, and talk about it. Does that make sense? Don't fixate all our attention on it. We're going to talk about that. But acknowledge, I'm having a struggle with this. Thomas did that. Second, don't disconnect from the Christian community. I'm having a doubt. It breaks my heart that I'll have a student attending church, and they'll go off to a college class, and it'll challenge something about their belief in God, or Christianity, and then just stop hanging out with Christians. They won't ask anyone about the question that's bothering them. And I want to say that we take it very serious when people say, hey, I have this question, I have this doubt. We'd love to walk with you through that. So if you're here and doubts come up, we'd love to talk to you about them. Not because we're the answer people that have all the answers, but because we love you, and as a part of your Christian family, we want to walk with you through those things and point you to the truth. Amen? I have in the past, and probably should start doing that again when kids go off to college, I've sent letters to say, if you have a question, if something comes up, please let us know. We won't come down on you. We won't judge you. We just want to help you process. So when we're in a doubt and disbelief, don't disconnect from the Christian community. 3, doubt your doubt and disbelief. Keller in his book has talked about that. You know, sometimes we'll say, well, that's not a matter of fact, that's a matter of belief. But we seldom say, that's not a matter of fact, that's a matter of disbelief. So we have to sometimes doubt our doubt, doubt our disbelief. By the way, when we're in conversations with folks who are having doubts, let's pray that we can have confidence, but let's also pray that we can be humble. I remember on occasion I was asked to be in a discussion / debate with someone who was from the belief system of the Jehovah Witnesses about the deity of Christ. Now this person had asked, Pastor, you've studied this, why don't you come and talk to them about this? And so I had a prayer group. These are spiritual issues, right? Like we should never go into discussions of doubt and disbelief without praying for the empowering of the Holy Spirit. Amen? So I prayed that, and I had a group of folks before I went into this to say, hey, would you pray for me that God would grant me clarity of thought and that God would grant me wisdom in how I address this? And I started in to the room where the discussion / debate was going to happen. And I stopped. Because as I was praying, I believe the Holy Spirit was saying to me, there's something else you need to have them pray for before you go. And that is that you will be humble and that you will love the person you're speaking to. Does that make sense? That you'll be humble and you'll love the person you're speaking to. See, I am a recovering competitive jerk. Okay? And what can happen sometimes is instead of loving the person with the doubt or the area of belief that we disagree with, we make it into some kind of contest. And I realize there's all these people that want to come out and say, Pastor, that was great. You did great. I really liked your answer to that. And I didn't want people talking about me when it was over. We want them talking about Jesus. We also need to pray for humility, so that we don't think we have to be the answer person to everything. It's good sometimes to say, I don't know, let me look into that. And then we remain connected to the greater Christian community. I think it's fantastic that when people come to Christ, very seldom is it just one person that talked to them. Somebody years ago did some research and found the average person has talked to 7 people, right? We should never be dependent on one person. And so when we're dealing with someone's doubt and disbelief, or our own doubt and disbelief, we shouldn't suspect that just one person is going to do it. God's going to speak through lots of different people. Make sense? Other thing is a lesson that I repeat so often because I need to be reminded of it. And that is, start where they do believe and then move to where there's disbelief. Bill Hybels, I tell this story often, he was on a plane one time and the person next to him said, I've almost given up on that Christianity stuff. And Bill turned to him and said, tell me about the almost part. Why haven't you given up yet? And that was an epiphany to me, because I realized most of the time I would have jumped into, well, what do you disagree with? What do you got a problem with? Might be much smarter to go, well, why haven't you given up? Where's God working in your life? Does that make sense? Start with areas of agreement and then move on to those areas where there's disagreement, but do that graciously. If it's our own doubt and disbelief, start doubting it. Help other people ask questions about it. How do you know that's true? Where are you getting your information from? So after we've declared our doubt and disbelief, not disconnected from the Christian community, doubted our doubt and disbelief, we need to discover the truth. I can say to you that every time I've went through a period of doubt and disbelief, I've come out on the other side more sure of my faith than when I went in. But I can also say, especially in my college years, I was scared by some of the responses of people who call themselves Christians. And I'm not saying they weren't Christians. They would panic when you would say, hey, I have a doubt about this. What? It's like they expected now in 10 minutes they were going to give me something that was going to remove my doubt. Discover the truth. Peter Marshall, who used to be a chaplain to the Senate, said, if you want to win an argument, start by being right. And then second, live in such a way that people would want you to be right. I wrote that on something I was going through ordination, and someone said, be cautious, that sounds kind of harsh. I think you're misunderstanding what he was saying. What he was saying is this, talk less, research more. Does that make sense? Talk less, research more. Some of you have Facebook. You know that there are times when people get way out there past what facts would have. They start getting upset and they just start firing stuff. I think he's saying, make sure that what you say is true to the best of your knowledge. And where it's not, admit that you're not sure of it. We can go a long ways just by saying to somebody, let me look into that. When they make a statement, well, I don't think, fill it in with whatever kind of disbelief is there. I don't think God really exists anymore, or I don't believe the Bible anymore, or I don't, whatever, or I never have, never will. When they say those things, instead of us jumping in with a statement of our own, maybe it's just ask a question. Really, tell me a little bit about that. Well, let me look into that. I know some other folks that might be able to help us with this. Those kind of things. Because it's very tempting to start trying to win arguments without loving people. And to start winning arguments even when you don't know what the facts are. The second part of what he said and the discovery of truth was, if you want to help other people discover truth, be the kind of person that other people would want you to be right. Do you understand what he meant by that? This is very scriptural, by the way, about being loving. There are people, we can often somehow be blind to it in ourselves, but we see it pretty quick in other people, that we say, you know what? I'm grasping for straws here, but I won't give up because I don't want that person to be right because they're going to rub my face in it. And I think Peter Marshall is saying, don't be that kind of person. Be humble. Be loving. Understand, the only reason that we know that some of the things we know is because of the grace and love of Christ to us. So be loving and gracious as you discover the truth. And the last point is, demonstrate your belief. Demonstrate your belief. Give testimony to your journey. When I first told the story of my doubt that day in the car, or told of other times that I've had doubts, there are some who say, don't speak like that, Pastor. It'll rock somebody else's faith. Like my thought was, faith in what? If it's their faith in me that comes down a little bit, I'm okay if they get more faith in Christ. Amen? I'm not to be put on a pedestal. Christ is. That's what John said. He wrote everything so that people would believe in Jesus. The truth is that we go to battle with doubt and disbelief at times. Amen? The truth is there's some stuff that happens and we go, I don't have any idea, God, why you're letting this happen. And I know a lot of people get ministered to when we're really honest and we demonstrate our belief and say, you know, but God got me through that. Praise the Lord. Isn't it good to know that Thomas came to a point, he said, unless I see this, I'm not believing, never. And Jesus came to him, and he became an apostle, and he brought the message. If what we hear outside of Scripture is true, he brought the message of Jesus Christ as far as India. Praise the Lord. Because it wasn't over the day he said, I don't know, I don't believe unless I see. So demonstrate your belief and know that Jesus is the author and perfecter of our faith. And it is by His grace that we cling to Him. Amen? Don't we want to be a place here at Edgewood that people overcome their doubt and their disbelief and we journey together in the joy of knowing Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith.